As a park ranger and historian here at Richmond, one of the questions I'm asked a lot is why? Why did the Confederates pick Richmond as their capital? It's only 100 miles from Washington, D.C. Seems kind of stupid that you might do that. Well, the easy answer is the Confederates couldn't afford not to. Richmond had everything they would need. Tobacco factories, ironworks, flour mills, woolen mills, everything they would make for the possibility of fighting a four-year war. So when I say that the Confederates couldn't afford not to, that's what I mean. Where else in the South do you have that kind of industrial capability? It doesn't exist. So Richmond is not only a political capital, but also an industrial and commercial capital as well. In 1861, you've got Jefferson Davis, you've got Robert E. Lee, P.G.T. Beauregard, all crowding into the city, along with office seekers, people looking for jobs, people looking for commissions, all ramping up for this big fight that's going to come. Now remember, at the time, everybody thought this was going to be a very short war. Both sides offered 60-day enlistments. Think about that. 60 days, 90 days, and we'll be done. So it's a sort of creeping realization, oh, we need to do something more than just this ad hoc. We need to create hospitals and prisons and all the things we're going to need to run a government. And that's what they do. A lot of the buildings behind me were used as Confederate hospitals, Confederate prisons. But all of a sudden in 1862, as George B. McClellan's army comes up the Virginia Peninsula, you've got these huge battles that are taking place right outside the city. Robert E. Lee comes to command and jumps McClellan, attacking him north of the city and forcing him away. These are the 7 days battles that take place around Richmond. And just imagine standing here while that was going on. You could hear it. You could see it. You could see the flashes of the cannon. You could feel it in your bones as the cannons literally rattled the ground. And for years and years, people have been coming up here to take in the sunset. And now imagine that, this scene of destruction. Lee was able to drive McClellan away, and it would be 2 years before the Union Army would come back. But during that time, the problems arose in the Confederate capital that start to show you that the Confederacy isn't built on solid ground. Inflation takes hold. You've got runaway prices down there in the market. At one point in 1863, people took to the streets to riot because the Confederates could not provide them food. This is often called the bread riot in town, and it took out a lot of the downtown shops and stores where you had not just food, but jewelry and anything that could be carried off was. And it definitely shows you internally that the Confederates have got a real problem at the heart of the Confederacy. This sets the stage for 1864 when U.S. Grant and the Army of the Potomac come once again to the gates of Richmond. This is going to result in the Battle of Cold Harbor, and once again, the people of Richmond could stand here and feel the ground shaking under their feet as a massive battle erupted just 10 miles outside the city. Lee's army was able to hold off the Army of the Potomac, and once again, the Army of the Potomac moved away from Richmond, down to Petersburg this time, where for 9 months, the two armies would face off. Battle would come again to the outskirts of Richmond at Fort Harrison in September of 1864, right before the U.S. presidential election. All through this time, you have amazing events going on in Richmond, like a fire at the Tredegar Ironworks right on the eve of Lee's invasion of the North. By 1865, though, the writing was on the wall, with Lee and Grant more or less facing off each other for 9 months down at Petersburg. Anybody who was really paying attention to Richmond could see something was going to happen, and something was going to happen soon. And it did. On April 2nd, 1865, Lee's lines are broken at Petersburg, and the city began to evacuate itself. Overnight, Confederates moved out. They set fire to a lot of the warehouses in the lower part of the city. That fire got out of control. And the next morning, when the Union Army came in to the city, they became firefighters. They put out the fire and restored order. And ever since then, the U.S. flag has flown over the Capitol behind me.